Hello friends and welcome back to my channel. I'm excited to dive into an intriguing topic today. We're going to explore the question, is it possible to use generative AI as a personal tutor to gain one-to-one tuition? To do this, I'll be using a paper I had published as part of a research team and Bing AI in the Microsoft Edge browser to tackle this question head on. Before we do that, let's understand why one-to-one tuition is crucial in education. Did you know that research by Benjamin Bloom, a renowned educational psychologist, revealed that students who had access to one-to-one tuition tended to achieve 2 standard deviation points more progress than those who just had access to a classroom setting? So here's the twist. Can freely available generative artificial intelligence tools like Bing AI provide you with your own personal tutor that adapts to your learning style and pace? Well, today we're going to try to find out. We'll do this by looking at how we can use AI to test our knowledge and comprehension, then also how we can use AI to engage in analysis, discussion and debate to develop our learning further. So let's head over to Microsoft Edge. The reason for using Bing AI in Microsoft Edge is that I don't have to copy and paste the article into an AI app. I can access the contents straight from this page. I've put a link up here to a previous video that shows you how you can download the Edge browser. So let's begin. I'm going to use a research paper that I published entitled The Use of Facebook in Social Work Practice with Children and Families, Exploring Complexity in an Emerging Practice. Before carrying out any of the following activities, I'd encourage my students to read the whole paper, as this is a very important step that you shouldn't overlook. Then to explore if Bing AI can act as a personal tutor, in Edge, I'd select the B, then Chat, and select the more precise conversation style. Now let's create a 10-question multiple choice quiz based on the article on this page. Are you ready? Let's do this. To begin with, I'd type into Bing, create a 10-question multiple choice quiz based on this article. Then ask me questions one at a time to test my recall. Provide the correct answer after I've responded to each question. After the final question, give me my score out of 10. So I'd put this in, and then what Bing will do is it will start to generate some questions. So let's have a look at the first one. Question one is, what is the main aim of the study that this article reports on? And then it asks me the following questions. A, to find out how social workers used Facebook to gain another view of service users' lives. B, to find out how social workers established and sustained long-term relationships with service users in child protection cases. And C, to find out how social workers used social media to communicate with service users and other professionals. And D, to find out how social workers use social media to conduct ethical and legal assessments of service users. So then it asks me, well, please type in A, B, C or D as your answer. I'm going to put in A and it states that is correct. Then it moves on and asks me the next question. Then it poses some further questions to me. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to fast forward all of the questions and my responses. You can pause the video at any stage to look at the types of questions that Bing generated. Then right at the end, it says, congratulations, you've completed the quiz. Let's calculate your score. It shows that I answered 8 questions correct out of 10. And I did answer a couple of questions inaccurately just to see if Bing picked those up. I found Bing quite good in terms of testing my knowledge and comprehension. Some of the questions were a bit repetitive, but I didn't really mind that because having read the article, it made me think about why they were repetitive. So was the quiz useful as a personal tutor? I think it encourages recall and comprehension quite well. So I think that this is actually quite a solid start. Now let's kick things up a notch. Learning is not just about memorizing facts. It's about applying, analysing, discussing and debating knowledge in real-world type scenarios. So to move my personal tutoring on using AI a little bit, I'm going to pose this question. I am a newly qualified social worker. Based on this research paper, create a question of a potential scenario I may face in a future social work situation. Let me answer the question, then assess my response based on this research paper. And I really like the question then that Bing poses. It starts off by saying that you are working with a family where the father has a history of domestic violence and substance abuse. You've been told by your manager to check his Facebook page regularly to see if he's still in contact with his ex-partner and their children, who are under a child protection plan. You feel uncomfortable about this practice and wonder if it is ethical and legal. What would you do in this situation? I can see that Bing is drawing on the paper in terms of presenting this ethical situation. I want to see how it responds to my response. So I would say, I would ask the manager if I should look at the Facebook page without consulting the legal department first. I would be concerned about the legal implications of undertaking this form of surveillance and the potential impact it might have on my relationship with the family. I am aware that my first duty is to protect the children, so I may have to carry out the visit first. And what I want to do is I want to see what Bing comes back with, because a personal tutor would then help me explore this in a little bit more detail. And this is Bing's response. Your response is well thought out and demonstrates a good understanding of the ethical and legal considerations in social work. You've correctly identified the need to balance your duty to protect the children with respect for privacy and legal boundaries. It's important to consult with your manager or legal department when you're unsure about the appropriateness of certain actions. Remember, maintaining a positive and open relationship with families is crucial in social work, and actions that may be perceived as intrusive can potentially harm this relationship. Keep up the good work. Again, the responses are really generally quite accurate, and I can tell as the author that they've drawn on the paper. And so this is actually quite good because it's stimulated my thinking a little bit about what I would have read and how I would have applied it to a real life type situation here. And I think as a generative AI personal tutor, it's actually doing quite a good job in prompting my thinking. But wait, there's more. Learning shouldn't be just one way. So let's see if we can push the boundaries a little bit. I'm going to create a challenge here, because with a human personal tutor, I should be able to have a little bit of a back and forth about their responses and my responses to explore the situation further. Let's see if we can do this with Bing. To begin this process, I pose the following to Bing. Based on this research paper, pose a 150 word length ethical dilemma I may face in a future work situation. And I've reduced it to 150 words because anything more than that could potentially become way more complex. So this is the ethical dilemma that Bing then presents to me. You are a social worker who works with children and families in child protection cases. You have access to a team Facebook account that is used to monitor or surveil the online activities of service users without their consent. You are aware that this practice may be illegal, unethical, and potentially harmful to the therapeutic relationship. However, you also feel that it may provide valuable information that could help you assess the risks and needs of the children and families you work with. You are unsure how to balance your professional duties, your personal values, and the expectations of your manager and organisation. How would you handle this situation? In response, I would seek legal advice about the legality of my actions. I would also look at the professional codes of practice. However, before all of this, should I not put the well-being of the children first? And this is me posing a question now back to my personal tutor. And I quite like the response that I get. Bing says, "You're absolutely right. The well-being of the children should always be the primary concern. However, it's also important to consider that maintaining trust and respect in your professional relationship can contribute to their well-being too." And that is true, actually. So breaching privacy could potentially harm these relationships and consequently the children involved. Seeking legal advice and referring to professional codes of practice, as you mentioned, are excellent steps to ensure that your actions are both ethical and legal. And I'm quite glad that it's responded in this way. And it acknowledges that it's a complex situation with no easy answers. But your thoughtful consideration of all aspects is commendable. I feel really quite proud of the fact that it said that to me. And then it concludes, remember, open communication with all parties involved can often help in navigating such dilemmas. I really do like that response. So rather than just stop there, I'm going to have a bit of a back and forth. So I pose this question. So, should I put the well-being of the children above the legal and ethical considerations? Because this is something that I'm really quite interested to know about. And Bing responds, the well-being of the children is indeed paramount. However, legal and ethical considerations are also crucial, as they often serve to protect the well-being of individuals, including children. It's not about putting one above the other, but rather finding a balance where you can ensure the children's well-being while also respecting legal and ethical boundaries. This might involve seeking alternative methods to gather necessary information or obtaining informed consent where possible. Remember, every situation is unique and may require different approaches. It's always a good idea to seek advice from supervisors or legal counsel when facing such dilemmas. And I think that that final sentence actually is really, really important. And one, if I was new to the field, that I would take away as a very, very important learning point. I'm not finished yet, so let's push this a little bit further. So I ask, what if my supervisor tells me to keep surveillance on the family, but states that I have to tell them that I'm monitoring their online profiles? Is this ethical? And based on the research paper, Bing responds, if your supervisor instructs you to inform the family that you're monitoring their online profiles, it introduces a level of transparency into the process. And that is true. This is what our research found. This can be seen as more ethical than conducting surveillance without their knowledge. Again, this is true. However, it's important to consider how this may impact your relationship with the family and their trust in their services you provide. And Bing goes on to say, ethics in social work are often complex and context dependent, which is true. It's crucial to consider the potential benefits and harms of any action. In this case, while monitoring might provide valuable information for child protection, it could also cause distress or harm to the family. And again, that is absolutely true. Remember, ethical guidelines and laws are in place to help navigate these complex situations. If you're unsure, it's always a good idea to seek advice from an ethics committee or legal counsel. Ultimately, the decision should be guided by what is in the best interests of the children and families you serve. And by responding to me in this way, I am starting to think more about the issues than I would by simply just reading the paper on its own. Then I ask it quite a cheeky question. What would you do? And I get this really quite interesting response. As an AI developed by Microsoft, I don't have personal experiences or emotions, so I don't make decisions like a human would. However, based on ethical guidelines and principles, it's important to balance the well-being of the children with respect for privacy and legal considerations. Transparency, informed consent, and adherence to professional codes of conduct are key in such situations. It's always advisable to seek guidance from supervisors, ethics committees, or legal counsel when facing such dilemmas. Remember, every situation is unique and may require a different approach. And again, this really draws out, in essence, what we have in the paper. I also wanted to push this a little bit further. So I ask, I'm confused. According to this paper, what is the difference between surveillance and monitoring? And what I like is again, it draws on the paper and quite accurately describes what the difference between the two approaches are. So according to the current webpage context, the difference between surveillance and monitoring is, surveillance is the covert observation of service users' online activities without their consent or knowledge. And I like that it's put in bold, covert and without their consent or knowledge. It may involve accessing their Facebook pages, creating fake accounts, or using third-party platforms to gather information. Surveillance is often seen as unethical, illegal, and potentially harmful to the therapeutic relationship. Again, this does pick up and draw really quite accurately on the findings in the paper. And then it says that monitoring is the overt observation of service users' online activities with their consent or awareness. And again, I like the fact that it's put in bold, overt, with their consent or awareness. It goes on to say that it may involve informing them that their Facebook pages are being viewed, obtaining their permission, or sharing the findings with them. Monitoring is often seen as more ethical, legal, and respectful of the service user's privacy and dignity. And again, this is quite accurate in terms of what's put in the paper. I've really found it quite intriguing to undertake this experiment. And this interaction does offer insights and allows me to explore from different angles the paper. And it also offers a glimpse into the potential of AI to act as a learning companion. It certainly made me think and look at issues from different angles in a way that I wouldn't have done without posing these questions to somebody who was bouncing back ideas to me. So, can generative AI act as a personal tutor for one-to-one tuition? I'd say yes, to a certain extent. It can support and scaffold your learning, especially when used alongside a really well-designed curriculum. What we've seen is that tools like Bing AI can boost knowledge recall, comprehension, application, and even analysis, synthesis, and evaluation. It can actually turn out to be quite a versatile learning companion, but what's important is the prompts that you actually put in to gain the depth of learning back from this tool. Now, after watching this video, do you believe that tools like Bing AI can enhance your learning experience? I would really love to hear your thoughts, so make sure you put them in the comments section below. Before I wrap up, don't forget to like, subscribe, and share this video with fellow learners and educators. Your support means a lot to me. I've created other videos about using AI in education. Do make sure to check them out for further insights. The link to them is just here. And until next time, take care, keep learning, and embrace the power of AI in education. Bye.